this?
Yeah, that's great. Okay, it's 12, a bit past 12 o'clock, and other people will come in. But we have, how many people online? 13, 14? Hello to people online out there in the world. Can you guys, you can just see this, can't you? Okay, when we have a discussion after the talk, you'll see that there are people out, mostly in Europe, because we're starting at a time that makes it difficult for the Americans. Okay, it's my great pleasure to present again Professor Andrew Chesterman of the University of Helsinki. Professor Chesterman is Professor of Multilingual Communication, albeit recently retired from the University of Helsinki. And he has been with us and is with us here in Tarragona for 1 month as what's called in Catalan Catedratic d'Excellencia, which we might translate as an excellent professor or a professor of excellence, however you like. Okay, he's been with us to help us with our research culture, particularly in translation studies, but more generally in language studies and the humanities. He has particular interests in research methodology and how to complete your doctoral thesis for those who are engaged in that adventure, as most of us here are, and others who are doing research work at undergrad or at master's level. Okay. I think we'll get going because we advertised on the webcast that we would start at 12 o'clock, and people will come in as they finish their classes.
All right.
Okay.
So,
Andrew.
Thank you, Anthony, and thank you for the kind invitation to come to Tarragona. I'm enjoying my few weeks here very much. Certainly a lot warmer than Finland at this time of year. And I've had some interesting discussions. Culminating this morning with a long discussion about the floor in one of the rooms.
F-L-O-O-R.
Indeed. Oh, how witty. Okay, explanation, or understanding explanation. This is what I would like to talk about now. It's a subject which I've found increasingly interesting.
Close to the microphone.
I will. Okay.
Peter.
Okay, right.
Yeah.
Is that better? Sorry.
Yes.
Why explanation? I first started getting interested in explanation when I read the title of Gideon Turi's book, Descriptive Translation Studies and Beyond. 1995, because the beyond seemed to me to suggest something beyond description. Just pause for a moment, there's more people coming in. Okay. So the idea seemed to be in that book that specifically norms were being proposed as explanatory hypotheses in translation. And the idea seemed to be that if research in translation studies, or perhaps in any of the humanities, was to make progress, that we of course can start with description, but we need to progress to explanation. And I began to wonder what the difference actually was between description and explanation, and I went to read what I could find in the philosophical literature about explanation, and I thought it was extremely interesting, and I thought that this is something that I wish I had known about before, when I started my own research work, even before I started my doctorate. I should like to have known more about these things. And so I thought it might be a good topic to discuss with you. So what I propose to do is to say something like this, after a few introductory notes. I'm going to suggest that there are four different ways of explaining anything. I'm going to be focusing particularly on the humanities, but some of my examples will be also from the natural sciences. I want to present these as being different ways of explaining, but I also want to argue at the end that they're all connected in a certain way. as we shall see. So, by way of introduction, it's useful to consider the way we use the word explain in everyday life. What kind of things do we want to explain? And it seems to me that we normally talk about explaining these sorts of things, something which is surprising, such as a generalization, even, which surprises us for some reason or other, some kind of a puzzle or a problem, how something works, for example. But basically, anything that we don't understand, we try to explain, or we ask somebody for an explanation. And the explanation is supposed to bring understanding. So when somebody explains something to you, then you say, aha, in a wise kind of way, and you assume, you hope, you believe that you have understood something a bit more than when you started. Which might, of course, not be true. It might not be a correct explanation. I think that's interesting to think about that. For example, as a child in England, age 3, 4, 5, you may be surprised on Christmas Day morning to wake up and find that under the Christmas tree or on the end of your bed, in a sock, there are presents, usually in the stocking, okay, traditionally in England on Christmas Day. And you go into your parents' bedroom and you say, Mummy, Daddy, where are all these presents come from? You know, this is amazing. I didn't know I was going to get all these things, although you put your stocking out in hope of something. Where do they all come from? And then what's happening? And then at some point somebody says, well, Santa Claus brought the presents. Father Christmas brought the presents. And you say, ah, I see. Now I understand. Of course, it's not perhaps true, you might say, in a literal sense. But it's an explanation that satisfies you at the time, which is interesting. And it seems to me that one of the first things to realize about explanations is that they are pragmatic speech acts that take place in a certain context. Somebody asks a question and somebody answers it. That seems to be where we start. So we try to understand anything, any explanandum, any puzzle, by offering some explanation for it. And I'm going to argue that these three concepts are all connected then. So explaining and describing and interpreting are all somehow linked up with the idea of bringing more understanding. Understanding may lead to knowledge, may lead to knowledge which is true, you might say, to the extent that any knowledge is true, but not necessarily, because of the subjective element in it. So what are the kinds of things we can explain in everyday language? We could start by saying, well, you could explain what something means. There was a lecture here a few days ago in this room dealing with the communication of risk. And the lecturer used the word recreancy, which was for me a completely new word, which I'd never heard of, I don't think, and certainly wasn't sure what it meant. And I had to go to the Google when I got back to the hotel room and find out what it was. And I discovered what I thought it was, though I now can explain what I think it means, which I will not do now. Go Google, you could say. But an explanation can simply be a description of what something means. I think that's a sort of starting point. So from this point of view, you could say that an explanation is an interpretive hypothesis. It's an interpretation of what something means. Just stop for a moment, more people are coming in.
Classes have just finished.
There are more people coming in, okay. So this is part of the introduction to those of you who've just come in, trying to set the scene by describing the kinds of different things that we set out to explain before moving on to four basic ways of explaining. So when one interprets something, which is a kind of explanation in the broad view of explaining, you are explaining something as something else. You explain X as Y. So we can explain light as, in terms of the metaphors of particles or waves or whatever. You can explain translation or interpret translation as cannibalism, or as crossing a bridge, or unpacking clothes in a suitcase, or a million other ways in which you can explain or interpret translation. Now, this is a very weak sense of explaining, but I think it is nevertheless a sense, because what it does is to relate something which we think we don't understand to something which we do understand. If you see light as waves, or light as particles, we have some idea what waves and particles are, and it makes it somehow easier to understand, more familiar, by relating what you don't know to what you do know. So you are seeing a similarity between the puzzle and something which is not so puzzling. And I think that's one of the ways, one of the places where explanation starts. So metaphors are extremely important. Metaphors are first ways of understanding anything, because you are interpreting something as something else. And the interpretation helps you to make sense of something. But then there are descriptions, of course, too. And you could also say that by describing something, you are also making it clear. You're also making sense of it, in a way. We'll look at this in a little bit more detail in a few minutes. If you are describing X as a kind of Y, or describing the features of X, then you are shedding light, you're making sense of it, and it might be one way of answering the question, this is a puzzle, please could you explain it to me? And by explaining it, by describing how it fits in, how it forms one subclass of something else, for example, you could say that that also is explaining in a loose way, which I will come back to. Describing can also be something that you do to a process, rather than describing a phenomenon or an object. One can describe how something works. And I think this is also a very basic sense of explaining. You can describe how a car engine works, if you happen to know such things. Or you can explain how to do something. In translation studies in recent decades, there has been quite an interest in explaining different aspects of the process of translating. We have been using think aloud protocols, recordings of people who are asked to speak aloud as they translate. We've been using translog, which is a way of recording every keystroke that you use on the computer as you translate. It's a way of describing how people operate a computer, how they process the language, how they write it down as they translate. And you can discover strange and interesting things in this way. Other people have looked at workplace procedures, describing the ways in which translators, for example, use reference works, or how much coffee they drink during the day, or how they telephone their friends when they're stuck, all kinds of strange things which affect the whole process, the sociological process. So these are descriptions of how something is done, and they also shed light, they also help, they contribute to understanding. But then there is a third kind of explaining, which are perhaps more complicated, more to be desired perhaps, that shed more light than other things, which are really what we would want to call explanations in a more serious sense, rather than merely interpretations or descriptions, because these have to do with questions of why is such and such the case. or what something is for. They are questions having to do with what are the possible or sufficient conditions leading to the existence or form of a phenomenon or other. And for many people, these are central. These are perhaps for some the only ways in which we could understand explanation. For me, I think explanation is a broader topic, and I would defend a wider use of the words, certainly in the humanities. But I want to say something more about all these different ways of explaining by analysing them in terms of four basic types. But certainly the why questions are, I think, the big ones. Certainly in translation studies, these are the questions that we are moving towards increasingly, beyond simply questions about what are translations like and how do translators work. We're moving towards questions about why, I think. So, to summarise, roughly speaking, what we've been saying so far, you could see an explanation as a hypothesis which is offered to be some way of making sense of something, as a way of answering a question which seeks an explanation. One philosopher talks about explanation-seeking questions. It's what your child asks you at that certain stage when children begin to ask these why questions, when it's never enough to say, because I say so. There have to be other answers to the why questions. Something very, very basic about growing up and learning to think. But the two things highlighted in red there are, I think, two interesting key points. The first one, the hypothesis that explanations then are not necessarily truths, they are not facts, they are hypotheses, they are proposals, they are suggestions, they are ideas that can be tested in some way. Therefore I use the word hypothesis. And the purpose of an explanation is to make sense, or to make more sense than there was before, you could say. Think of your primitive Iberians living in a cave somewhere on the coast of Catalonia, I don't know how many thousand years ago, 10,000 years ago perhaps, and they look out of the cave in the evening and they see the moon moving across the sky, and one of the little Iberians says to his mum, "Mum, mum, why is the moon moving across the sky?" And mum, probably not dad, because I expect dad's out hunting the wolves or something, but mum is there, and she says, "Well, my son, or my daughter, my child, the moon is being pulled by four white horses across the sky, but they are magic horses, and that's why we can't see them." And the child says, "Ah, I see, that is why the moon is moving across the sky." And so our myths are born. Myths are explanations of why things are. Think of the myth of Babel. Why do we have so many languages in the world? Ah, well, it's because there were these guys building this tower and God didn't like it, and etc., etc. You know the story. And it makes sense. It helps you to make sense of something. These are also kinds of explanations. Before we get to the four types, which I want to go into in a bit more detail, I want to make two very brief digressions. The first one is the connection between explanations and predictions. There's a very close relation between the two, but they're not quite the same. It's not the case that if you can explain something, you can always predict it, because you can explain after the fact rather more often than you can predict. And you can often explain rather general terms more than you can predict. I can predict, vaguely speaking, that every year somebody will fall through the ice as the lakes freeze in Finland. They will go out on the ice when it's too thin and somebody will fall in. Or a tractor will drive over the ice and it will fall in and somebody will be drowned. It happens every year. But I can't really predict who will do this? But it's very easy to explain. When Farmer Jones goes over the ice in his tractor and falls in and drowns, if I'm asked to explain why, I can easily explain that he did it because he thought the ice was thicker than it really was. But it would have been much more difficult to predict that Farmer Jones would have been precisely him going out over the ice, and so on. So one uses predictions to test explanations, because if you think your explanation is right, and you can base a prediction upon an explanation, you can test it in that way. And they're usually probabilistic rather than absolute in many cases. But what they both share is that they reduce surprise, and I think that's a key point of an explanation. It reduces your sense of being puzzled, your sense of being surprised. If you can predict that something's going to happen, one is not surprised when it does happen. If you can predict that somebody's going to fall through the ice this winter, and somebody does, you're not really surprised, because you have predicted it on the basis of past experience. The second digression has to do with the difference between these two terms, because there is a whole line of the philosophy of science in which these terms are made very distinct. There are people who will argue that explanation is something that you can apply to the natural sciences, not to the human sciences, not to the humanities. For us, they say, we should use the word understanding, not explanation. And I think some people still hold to that. I'm going to argue against it, really, because I'm going to argue that explanation and understanding, they go together. And some people would also argue that explanations can only be used from an essentialist philosophical point of view, and that understanding is much more non-essentialist. This is an argument that has divided translation studies for a few years, and I won't go into it in detail here. But for some people, this marks the divide between two ways of thinking about translation, as being more like a natural science demanding explanations versus more like literary studies or something, aesthetics, which is non-essentialist and demanding understanding rather than explanation. For me, it's enough to say that explanation leads to understanding, to greater understanding. So we now move on to the central section of the talk, which has to do with outlining these four different ways of explaining. In the narrowest sense of explanation, all explanation is causal. But in the broader sense, I think there are other kinds of explanation around the causal one. And as I said before, at the end of the talk, I will try to show connections between all four of these possible patterns, you might call them patterns of explaining. And I'm going to start with generalization. A generalization is normally thought of as being part of a description, part of a way of describing a phenomena. You have a case and, for example, and you try to generalize from it if you think it can be generalized. But if we think of what it actually means to generalize, it seems to me that part of its meaning is the claim that this case, X, which we are studying, is not isolated. It's not an isolated particular, but it is similar to some other cases, A and B and C. It's not all by itself, but it's like something else. That's what a generalization is, okay? That you can generalize from one case by showing the similarity between this case and other cases. So you are moving up a scale of abstraction. We are not just looking at X, but we're looking at X plus A plus B plus C. And if we can make a claim what is called a generalization about x plus a plus b plus c, then that claim is more general and therefore more powerful than the claim that we can make just about x. Now, there is a linguist who has taken this argument a bit further. I'll come back to Hempel in a moment. He argues, I think, very persuasively and very interestingly, this is Croft's argument, which I'm borrowing here, which has been applied to translation studies, for example, by Halverson and also by other people. This is the argument that the more you generalize, the more you move from description to explanation, that there is no strict dividing line between the two. That by moving from one level of generalization to the next, you actually approach real explanations. And here I'll give an example, an invented example. Suppose you are studying a simple translation. You have a source text and you have an original. Sorry, a translation. Okay? And you describe some basic, you observe some basic facts, and you say, well, noticing the differences between the source text and the target text, I noticed that there have been some shifts, some changes. And you simply describe the kind of shifts, the changes that you see. The first step in generalization, which Croft calls an internal generalization, would be to notice that these same kinds of shifts can be observed also in other translations, perhaps between the same two languages, perhaps between different languages or with other texts, so that the shifts that you started off noticing are no longer special or isolated, particular to that text, but you find them in other places as well. So if you find them in other places as well, not just in this text, you could be less puzzled. It would be a bit less strange that they were here in this first text, because you can also find them somewhere else. That would be one move up the scale. Then you can make a second move if you go on studying more and more languages, language pairs, and more translation types, and if you find that these shifts are coming up over and over and over again, it might occur to you that maybe whatever translation I look at, maybe there are going to be shifts. Maybe shifts are universal. So in that case, it would not be surprising that you have found internal generalizations if it is true that shifts are going to be found everywhere. Indeed, it would be surprising if you did not find them in your data, if you think they might be found everywhere. And gradually people begin to claim that maybe this and this and this type of shift, for example, is indeed universal. And then we can go and test to see what extent this is true. But there is a further step that you can also make, and for some people this would be the ultimate explanatory step, which would be to ask, if shifts are universal, why? And to answer that question, you would then move outside the particular field which has prompted you to make these earlier generalizations. And you would go outside into cognition, into communication, into culture, into something else, in order to explain why these shifts had been in the text in the first place. So Croft's argument is that every level of generalization actually is a kind of explanation, getting stronger as you move towards more general claims, because each shift in generalization, each move upwards on the scale, makes the particular cases that you started off with less puzzling, less special. And I think that's an interesting argument. If we now go back to this quotation, which comes from Hempel. Hempel is the great philosopher of empirical science, sort of standard basic text, to which Turi refers in several places, and which I've also referred to in some things. And this is Hempel's way of describing what any empirical science tries to do. But as we read it, I wonder whether you think that this will also apply to non-empirical disciplines, or in disciplines which are more hermeneutic-type disciplines, more human, rather more like a human discipline. I don't mean more empirical. I mean less natural sciences and more human sciences, because these seem to be very general formulations of the object of any kind of scientific research. So this is Hempel's formulation. So we try to describe particular phenomena, yes, to establish general principles. I'll come back to that a bit later too, by means of which they can be explained and predictive. These are formulated by generalizations and theories, and they characterize general patterns or regularities. So for Hempel, it seems that the whole enterprise of scientific research is, at its root, a search for generalizations, a search for regular patterns, as Turi once put it. Turi wrote somewhere that scholars are pattern-seeking animals, which I quite like. You're looking for the pattern, looking for the repeated shape, for the regular reoccurrences of things, so to find them and then to describe them and to interpret them and to explain them. I think this is so general and so basic that it must apply more widely than just to the natural sciences. But what I wanted to show here was the importance that Hempel gives to the idea of finding general formulations, generalizations that move above the particular. This seems to be absolutely crucial in his view of what constitutes scientific research. There is a risk, in fact there are two risks perhaps, in generalizations, making generalizations, which one should be aware of. The first one is that the generalization may actually not be justified at all, that you may be justifying from a case which is actually a special case and is not typical, not representative, and therefore your generalization is not justified. If you are studying the translation of haiku poems from Japanese into German, you may discover things that might not apply to the translation of legal texts between Catalan and French, because maybe there are too many differences, too many significant differences, which prevent the generalization. This is, I think, a fallacy that you sometimes find in arguments. I was recently reading a book by Theo Hermans in which he takes as an interesting case the Mormon Bible, or the Mormon sacred text, apparently translated by Joseph Smith from gold tablets given to him by an angel. And Hermans draws a number of conclusions about translation from this case. Now, to me, this is indeed a very, very special case of translation, not something that you could really generalize from. It's a very untypical case of translation. And for me, his arguments generalizing from this very special case are not persuasive, because it's the kind of case which is marked by very relevant differences with respect to other kinds of translation. So it's a risk to generalize from special cases. That's one risk. The other risk is that the more you generalize, it may be that the more you become trivial. There's a nice example of this in Gideon Turi's work, where he makes the same point, which I'm just going to make, precisely to illustrate the same thing. He says, suppose one generalized that all translations are characterized by shifts, that in every translation there is some change, something changes from the original. Well, you could say that that is such a very general generalization. There are shifts in translations, always, that it doesn't really tell us anything that we don't know already, or which is new or exciting. It doesn't seem to challenge anything except perhaps the idea that equivalence means identity. That idea we have to throw away if there are shifts. It would be much more interesting to make a more specific claim about the frequency of certain kinds of shifts, for example, rather than to simply say there are shifts. So it may be more interesting not to go for the most general level of descriptive generalization, but to choose the level which formulates the most interesting information. Between this particular case where I see an interesting shift at the bottom and right at the top, the level in which I simply say, ah, well, all translations contain shifts. Neither are very interesting from the point of view of finding the right level of generalization. True, for many scholars, generalization is a very weak form of explanation. It doesn't really so much answer the question why. That's true. But it does, I think, make you less puzzled. Because if you see similar things happening somewhere else, similar examples, you are perhaps less puzzled by the original examples that started off your inquiry. You could, of course, I suppose, be in some sense also more puzzled if you thought they were universal, because you would then need to ask, well, why? Why do we find these things? Okay, now we move on to the second type, which is, of course, the central and most typical type of explanation, the causal type, which has different formulations depending on how you frame it. You set out the conditions which you think cause something, or you formulate, you postulate a main cause, or you say this is made possible by this and this, and so on. I think this is fairly familiar, fairly straightforward. Translations, one is reminded, are both causes and effects. I think this is an important part of how translation studies has developed, because one doesn't just look at translations as having been caused by something, by various conditions, but we're increasingly interested in the different effects that translations of various kinds have on people. How do people react to translations of this or this or this kind? So one looks at both the causes and the effects, yes. In the literature on causality, one of the classical starting points is Aristotle, who made a classification which has been, I think, very widely followed by many scholars, and it's been applied to the humanities in many ways, and to translation studies as well, by Anthony Pym, among others. Just to remind you of these four basic kinds of cause, Aristotle's example was a statue, a marble statue. So the question is, why is the statue like this? Aristotle said, well, you've got four possible answers to the question. The material cause is the fact that it's made out of marble. That's why it's like this, because it's made of marble. Marble looks like this. You can do this. You can make this shape with marble. Well, translations are made of language, so you could say that translations are the way they are because of the way language works, because of the way the target language works, because of the relation between the target language and the source text, and so on. Then there is a final cause, the purpose cause. Why is the statue like this? Because that's what the man who ordered the statue wanted the statue to be like. I want a statue of Venus. Right, you don't get Hercules, you get Venus. This is what was ordered. Okay. This is, of course, Skopos theory in translation studies. Why is a translation like this? Because the purpose of the translation is this and this. Then there's the formal cause. Why is the statue of Venus like this, standing like this? You know the way they do, the statues of Venus? Aren't they like this, mostly? Or this, or something, or this, or whatever, okay. Well, that's what statues of Venus were supposed to look like in Greece in 400 BC, or whatever it is that you are considering. There were certain norms, certain expectations about what statues of Venus were supposed to look like. They didn't wear skirts or trousers. They wore something different. They, I won't go on into the details. But there were certain formal expectations. There were norms, in other words. And finally, there is the efficient cause. Why is this statue like this? Because it was made by Joe Bloggs, or Jonathan Smithos, or whatever he might be called in Greek. Okay. You've got the guy, he's a particular sculptor, he's got particular strength, he's a left-hander maybe, so he hits the chisel this way, not this way. He had a certain sort of chisel that he used, because this is the way he tends to make marble look like clothing. He has a particular personal style, etc., etc. So the translator in our field, translation studies. Most of you are, I think, or many of you are dealing with translation in one way or another. So we can apply these causes, these kinds of cause. That's very traditional, I think. But there are more modern ways also, more recent studies of causality, especially in the humanities, which I think perhaps bring extra depth to our understanding of causality. And one of the philosophers here is a Finnish philosopher. Perhaps the most famous Finnish philosopher, von Wright, he is pronounced in Finnish, not Wright, but Wright, because he was a Swedish speaker, and that's the way his name was pronounced in Swedish, von Wright. He was Wittgenstein's successor at Cambridge for a time, and he was a Wittgenstein scholar, among other things. And one of his key works, of which I will give you the reference at the end, is called Explanation and Understanding. And it has become a classical text for scholars and students in the philosophy of science. And if you don't happen to know it, I'd recommend it. It's not very hard to read. You can get the gist of it quite easily, quite interestingly, where he deals with the whole difference between understanding and explanation and tries to show what makes understanding special in the humanities and how it differs from the natural sciences and so on. So it's an interesting, basic, solid text, I think. And I take one idea from it here, in fact, another one in a moment. His understanding of causality is, I think, quite interesting. It overlaps to some extent with Aristotle's, but I think von Wright is more concerned with the internal logic of different ways of explaining. And he has these four types, and you'll notice that in the humanities that's yellow, and the idea here is that these two, which are yellow, which are highlighted, the quasi-causal and the teleological ones, these are central to the humanities. And these other two explanations, what he calls causal proper and quasi-teleological, these are less central to the humanities. But let me just explain briefly what they are. Causal proper is your standard basic idea of cause as a universal covering law, like the law of gravity. Okay? Why does this drop? Because of gravity. Okay? It's a law, it's a gnomic law, a regular law-like necessary truth. And the natural sciences make great use of such laws. But in the humanities and in translation studies, I think this sense of law, this sense of causality, is surely quite rare and quite difficult to apply. I'm not sure how relevant that sense would be to our field, to the humanities. And indeed, von Wright argues that the main types are quasi-causal and teleological. What's a quasi-causal quasi-causal explanation. Von Wright's example is the First World War, the causes of the First World War, one of his examples. And he says that this is the kind of cause that historians like to find, because what they do is to try to establish the particular conditions which contribute to something. So if a historian notes that before the First World War, this Archduke was assassinated, and there was this happening and that happening, and there was the armament here and there, and these relations were in this state, and he makes a long list of contributory factors that all help to make sense of the outbreak of the war. This is quasi-causal, because it's not gnomic. It's not the case that every time an archduke is assassinated, there is a world war. Okay? So you can't make it a regular, law-like thing. But it was one of the contributing things that happened, and altogether, if you look back at them, it makes more sense to understand. It makes it easier to understand why that war started. And I think this is something that's extremely relevant to the humanities, to the to translation studies and other such fields. If one can establish the relevant conditions which contribute to a given effect, a given result, a given phenomenon, then you've certainly made sense, you've helped to make sense of the phenomenon, in that you have contributed to answering the question, why did this phenomenon exist? If you can show how it's linked to a set of contributory individual conditions. So it's a weakish kind of cause. So that's why he says it's quasi-causal, not really centrally, properly causal. Then, of course, there's the theological idea, theological sense of cause, which is Aristotle's final cause, which for von Wright will be extremely important, because it's the way of explaining why by appealing to people's intentions and purposes. I do this because I want to achieve a given goal. And the last one is what he calls quasi-theological. One of his examples is the frog's legs. You know that frogs have long back legs. So you say, why, mummy, why do the frogs have long back legs? Okay, and mother says, well, my child, it's perfectly clear. The frog has long back legs in order to make it easier for him to jump better. Which is, of course, true in a way. It's the functional reason for the frogs having long back legs. And this is the way biological explanation often works. Well, in the humanities, there are institutions which have functions, and we talk about texts having functions, so maybe we can also consider that functional explanation has some relevance to our field, but perhaps not so central. This is the way von Wright analyzes this idea of purpose for as a model of explaining human action. This is what he calls his practical syllogism. It's a very tightly formulated argument. Okay, A is the actor. The actor intends a certain result. You cannot get this result unless you do X, and therefore you do X. So it's a way of trying to make logically very clear the link between the intended goal and the action which is supposed to lead to the goal. Okay. Now, for a long time, causality was considered to be the main or even the only form of explanation by many people. However, other views have become more widespread in the last 10 or 20 years. And one of the alternative views of explanation is the one which has been proposed by Wesley Salmon, in a very interesting book. I'll give you the reference also at the end if you would like to look at it. And he proposes what he calls unification,